What is up, my crew? My name is Steven, and you are listening to The Nook Podcast, where we are all about real faith in real time. Because following Jesus can be messy and challenging, and it happens in real time. The I Am Second movement began in 2008. The video testimonies started showing up online in countless places after seeming to appear out of nowhere. Since then, there has been a steady stream of these stories from a rather impressive and at times unexpected list of sports heroes, supermodels, singers, and TV stars.
I'm Brian Head Welch, and I am second.
My name is Joanna Gaines, and I am second.
I'm Tori Kelly, and I am second.
I'm Tony Dungy, and I am second.
My name is Kathy Ireland, and I'm second.
I was the video director at a large church at that time, and I very clearly remember how these videos made such an impact amongst the people who do what I do. I really appreciate that they have been around for a while now, and that these stories have been viewed and shared thousands of times all over the world. I have always been impressed by the candid nature of the people in these stories, proving that no matter what level of notoriety anyone might reach, we all deal with struggles, and we all need a savior. It took some digging, but I was able to make contact with one of the amazingly humble folks working behind the scenes on these short films. His name is Mike Jorgensen, and he has been involved since everything got started. I think you will enjoy his insight into the collective heart behind this organization. So settle in for my conversation with Mike Jorgensen. Mike, I am most curious because it seems to me like the I Am Second videos just kind of appeared. And I know that that was round about 2008. And being a church video guy at the time, all of a sudden it just seemed like everybody that I knew or that I had connections to was posting or commenting, or there was just this ravenous interest in the I Am Second videos. So it's an honor to talk to you, and I would just love to get an idea first and how things got started.
Yeah, thanks, Stephen. Back in 2007-2008, Norm Miller, who's the chairman of the board of Interstate Batteries, he has been a friend of our parent ministry, E3 Partners, for a long, long time. And he was just sharing with us one day that in his quiet time, that God had impressed upon him that he was supposed to go all out in his Jerusalem. And he had been helping us as an international church planting ministry and other international ministries. And he just felt called to go all out in his Jerusalem, which is Dallas. Hmm. And he said that God gave him a verse, John 12:32. If I be lifted up, I'll draw all men to myself. Hmm. And so a couple of guys on our staff had come out of the marketing world. Their names were Nathan and Adam. And so they just sat down and kind of started noodling, well, what could we do to go all out in Dallas and lift up Jesus? So they just had this at the time, crazy idea. Let's get some billboards and let's put pictures of famous people up there. And then that'll direct people to the website. And how are we going to get them there? Well, let's just call it I Am Second, because that'll people go, what in the world is that? Hmm. And so they took that idea to Norm and he said, great, I love it. Would E3 do it? And we're like, we're thinking, you know, our first thought is we're international church planters. Yes, we'll help with Dallas. I mean, that'll be fun. So because we expected it to be a short term Dallas evangelism thrust. Hmm. And so that's how it started.
So was the idea in there immediately about the video stories?
Yes, that was part of the original idea. We just do testimonies, and Nathan and Adam had a couple friends that are filmmakers, Scott and Sam. So they got them involved and said, well, now how can we do this in a, you know, a different way, a fresh way? We want to go for people who are far from God. And we're hoping that the church crowd will like them, but we're going for those people that are far from God. And so how can we do it in a way that does not sound churchy, is not what they're expecting? They started doing experiments with, first it was a black chair, actually, with a black background, and that just looked kind of spooky. That didn't work. So we shifted it and used a white chair, but with a black background, because the whole idea behind the original black and white was Christianity is as simple as black and white. And so let's just make it really simple. Let's make it so there's no distractions. There's not even a background. It's just dark. And so that's how the look and feel of it came about originally. And actually, the Holy Spirit has really used that, because when someone sits in that chair and we pray over them as a team, and then everybody kind of disappears into the shadows. And so the person sitting there is just the chair, the light, and all they can see is the lens of the camera. And the Holy Spirit has really used that to bring through out raw stories, very authentic stories. And it's because it feels intimate, even though they know it's going to go on a website. So God has really used that that setting, that studio, to accomplish his purposes in a way that we never expected.
So the set itself has basically sparked that vulnerability for whoever sits down.
Yes.
Oh, yes. That's...
It just feels like they're just talking. There's just a voice in the shadows that's asking questions every once in a while, but it feels like a very intimate, an intimate gathering.
Right. So, wow, it's almost like it becomes a confession booth of sorts.
Of sorts. And we have people that get up and say, you know, I have never told anybody that before. I mean, God just brings that type of authenticity to the chair. And other times people will say, you know, I never realized that until I was sitting there talking. And so we always pray that the Holy Spirit will bubble up in people's hearts and their minds what God wants them to share. And actually, it's often something new that even they didn't realize or they hadn't shared with anybody before.
So how is it that you were able to, or the, you know, I feel like I'm asking in full naivete, and I'm always just fascinated on how good stories are harvested, but how is it that the crew was able to tap into the level of stardom, for lack of a better term, for some of the people that you've had come in, the TV stars, the athletes and the like, that are then so obviously willing to come in and be so vulnerable to tell these deep, dark stories?
Well, in the beginning, and continuing, I guess, it's all about relationships. It's all about people knowing someone and that there being a trust level there. And obviously in the beginning, they didn't really know what to expect. But over time, we have developed a reputation by the grace of God that we're not about clickbait, for example.
Right.
We're not trying to take someone's story, someone's statement, and take it out of context and make it seem different than it really is. And so people feel that they can trust us with their stories. And also we had one celebrity tell us, you know, we have never been able to talk at length about any subject because we know that most people we talk to are just going to use it for clickbait.
Right.
And so, and this person essentially was saying, we trust you with our story, because we want it to be authentic to them. We're not using it to, you know, increase traffic or anything like that, although it does, which is wonderful. but we're not trying to make it anything sound like it's not. We want it to be the authentic story from their heart. So there's a trust level now that enables us to book more and more people to tell their stories.
That's a very interesting angle, especially when you consider that when some celebrity or similar has a big life change, that if there is some kind of interest in a news or a news-esque sort of program, that they're very likely going to want a very abbreviated, higher level angle of the story so that you don't get into those moments, because they're probably just trying to fill a 2 or 3 minute window and then the story kind of gets stifled. So I love that. I'm sorry, I'm just kind of processing this as we talk, that first of all, you're obviously gaining that reputation that I imagine at this point that whoever you reach out to, it's going to be a whole lot easier since you've got this great library of folks that have come before them, and that they are going to have that liberty to really share the guts of their story. I mean, is that a fair assessment?
Yes, definitely. And they're going to get to tell the full story. Hmm. I mean, we'll be editing it, but we want the whole story to be told, because life is nuanced, right? There's lots of different factors. There's lots of different things that enter into how we go from challenging situation and then how God brings us through to hope and peace and resolution. And it often takes more than a minute or two, certainly more than a 10-second soundbite,
sure,
to tell that story. And it's those stories that people find hope and peace in, because they can identify with the issue. Usually people come to our website because of celebrities, but then as they go and look at some of the other stories, many of which are just ordinary people, they can identify with the struggles, and they have hope that, well, if they did it and if God helped them in that situation, which is just like my situation, and I thought my situation was hopeless, but if he brought them through it, I can trust him to bring me through it. So it's transforming, because they sense the peace of God, and, you know, just surrender this to me.
Right. Well, and you saying that made me realize something that I had seen in the videos early on and to current day, that our stories don't all get wrapped up with a bow. I think that was one of the kind of walls that I ran into as a church video guy, is that it seemed like my leadership was always pushing me to bring the story to such a flourish. You know, I once was blind, but now I see. Well, that's awesome. But that doesn't mean that the story ends, that you've got these great people being so raw and vulnerable, and you get the you get a view of that story arc, but you can also see that just because they came through that doesn't mean that the story has ended. You're just getting a portion of it. So it's not promising some false hope that, here, just take this magic pill and everything is going to be awesome from here on out. I relate to that person because my story is similar, but also that we're still in this and it's still going to be work to keep at it.
We're all in process, right?
Yeah.
And we never reach perfection. We hopefully get more and more mature. But even that, even when we think we're headed in that direction, then we have a fall. So if you look at David in the Bible, I mean, a man after God's own heart, with such blessings and, you know, writing so many Psalms and everything. Yet when he failed, God said, "The sword will never depart from your household." So life was a constant struggle. He had to constantly be turning back to God, surrendering to God. And that's the stories we're trying to capture, is a episode may end, but there's going to be ongoing challenges as we follow Christ.
Sure. Which actually brings me to mind, I remember when I first saw the Josh Hamilton video years back that it was a great story, but I know that things were not rosy for somebody like him even after he told that story. Does that give you guys any shift when a story doesn't seem to play out with some sort of upward trajectory?
Well, the way we look at it is we stand behind what's in that film and what the people said at the time. And as people have ongoing struggles, that's part of their story. Yeah. And so we generally we leave them on the website because that was a moment in time. But that's just a good example of people having the same challenges over and over again.
Right.
And there's other times, though, when people say something that they've turned away from Christ or something like that. And so there are a few times we take something down if their walk has taken a dramatic turn. But we just take it on a case by case basis.
Sure. So I'm curious then, you say this all started with a focus on Dallas. Was there a certain point that everybody realized, wow, this is bigger than one city? And what did it look like to kind of scale it from there?
Yeah, it didn't take long. Our parent organization, E3 Partners, we do church planting training in about 50 countries. Mm. And so that was our focus. It wasn't an internet ministry at all. And so that was our first foray into the internet. And so we were all like, whoa, what's happening? Because it didn't take long for it to get to like 200 countries and things like that. I mean, like days, maybe weeks. But then it was like, oh, this is much bigger than Dallas. And so how do we embrace that? And so we've just continued to add more stories. And we wish we could do it in a lot of different languages and, a lot of different cultures. But that's a challenge for us. I mean, there's only so much budget, right? But we do have a lot of the films are subtitled. And if there's a particular film that does well in a particular country and, with the English speakers, then we can add subtitles.
Ah, so that's awesome.
Which is pretty easy to do.
Sure.
For example, we had a gentleman come to us with an internet ministry reaching into Pakistan. And one of the stories on the website seemed to be particularly helpful for people in that country, especially women in that country. And so we worked with him and got it dubbed into Urdu. And they did such a good job. If watching the film, you can barely tell that it's dubbed. I mean, it looks like this lady from the U.S. is speaking Urdu. So occasionally we partner in that way.
Okay. Well, then is that where things blossomed into? I mean, I know that there is some curriculum and things that encourage gathering and community around the I Am Second identity or idea. Is that when that started to play out?
Yeah, we, being a church planting organization, we've developed best practices for discipleship training, evangelism training, training people how to start new spiritual communities in ways that multiply. So they need to be simple, they need to be biblical, they need to be transferable. And so we decided, well, God gave this ministry to us, so let's use those best practices from the church planting side of things and integrate them into what we're doing with I Am Second. So we have very simple evangelism training, discipleship training. So we started with discipleship materials. The very first thing was we started with our films. We would choose a Bible story that was close to whatever issues were in that film. And they were discovery Bible studies. So we had film discussion guides so that believers could, hey, let's watch this I Am Second film together. They could do that with their friends. and then, you know, watch the film. It's kind of an icebreaker, and then discuss a Bible story that's similar. So, we added those, and we're getting ready here in another month or so. We've filmed some training films about how to tell your story in 30 seconds or less. Hmm. We're calling it the My Second Story Challenge. And then we'll have the next step will be, okay, you now know how to share your story. Now you need to know how to share God's story. So we have a very simple evangelism training films that people can watch. And then the third step is, well, now that you've been sharing Christ with people, and if you have people that are interested, what are you going to do with them? And so we have a training on how they can use our discipleship materials, the film discussion guides, and some other discovery Bible study materials to disciple their friends.
Okay, that's awesome. I love it that there is so much thought, and I'm going to assume prayer, in how to keep the thing rolling. Because in truth, something like this could just be a YouTube channel that gets a lot of hits. But I love that you've got depth to it, and then you're continuing to add depth to it.
Yeah. You know, our prayer is that this will be a filter to find people who want to take their next spiritual steps. Mm. And for some people, they need to trust Christ. That's their next spiritual step. So there's a evangelistic film on the website called Become Second, so they can watch that. But for other people that are already believers, they their next step may be to start to read the Bible, start to read the Bible with other people. And so we want to have those simple first steps available to them. And then once they do that, the methods we use are the same that we use in India and Germany and, you know, Asia. And so people don't realize it, but once they go through the I Am Second materials, they are qualified to go on a mission trip with our parent organization, E3 Partners, whether it's a virtual mission trip, which we've done a lot of those during COVID and are still doing some of them. But now that as the world is opening back up, we're starting to do regular mission trips again. So we use the same methodology when we go to another country. So people that take those steps with I Am Second, they're ready to go.
Okay. You mentioning other countries, this makes me realize there was something I definitely wanted to talk to you about. Because again, I was a church video guy, and so I was always looking around to see what other churches were doing, how they were telling stories, testimonies, and the like. And it was amazing to me how quickly the I Am Second look became the model for, well, that's how we've got to do it now. You find a cool looking chair and you go real simple in your lighting. And it seemed like every church that I knew of was using that look, and up to and including just a few years ago, what year was that? 2017 or 2018, I was in Israel and I did a story with One for Israel, which is a fantastic organization there. And I saw their set, and I said, this is awesome. And the first thing they talked about was, well, yeah, it's all based on I Am Second. And I'm like, this look will just keep regenerating itself. What does that copying say to you as an organization?
Well, imitation is the sincerest form of flattery, right? Mm-hmm. And so we always take it as, thank you, Lord. It's been helpful to someone else. And we loved working with One for Israel. They came and worked with our filmmakers on filming one or two of our films. So they kind of learned what we were doing, and then they adapted it for their audience. And they've done such an excellent job.
Yes, they have.
The storytelling is so superb. And the people imitating is actually pretty bittersweet. Because it's easy to copy the look and feel, but it's the storytelling that makes the difference.
Yes.
And soon after we launched, several months, I happened to run across a church webpage, and it was like a mosaic, and they had done, 20 or 30 or 40 films of people in their church telling an I Am Second style story. And I watched two or three of them, and I actually began to grieve. Not that they had done it. I was so glad they had done it. But if you listen to an I Am Second film, Jesus is the hero.
Yes.
But in every single one of those that they had copied, you know, they had tried to imitate, which is fine, the church was the hero.
Yeah.
Not Jesus. And they said, could so easily have made Jesus the hero, and then the the church still would have accomplished what it wanted to accomplish. So I would just say to those who want to imitate the style, great, go for it. If it's helpful, go for it. But pay attention to the storytelling, because that's what God is really going to use. And Jesus needs to be the hero of the story.
Has your target audience always remained the same as far as who you're making these films for, or is it a really wide swath?
We, well, again, it's not, there's not a simple answer to that. Originally it was, we were 100% focused on people far from God, and we wanted to broaden that by, you know, here's a musician, here's an athlete, here's a more, you know, ordinary person. So we wanted to reach, here's an older person, here's a younger person. So we wanted to reach different demographics and interests through the people that we film. And over time, we did a survey probably now a year and a half ago, and we discerned that about 30% of our audience are far from God when they first encounter I Am Second, and about 70% are following Christ. And so over the years, we have just messaged differently. We still want that outward focused messaging to be appealing to people far from God. But in the beginning, we could be mysterious. What in the world is I Am Second? And use that as a as kind of a draw. But now so many people know who I Am Second is, and our culture has changed so much last 12 years since we launched in 2008. Now it's we think it's even more important to be crystal clear about who we are and not be mysterious, because people value that authenticity.
Yes.
And to be a Christian today in our culture is more challenging than it was in 2008. And so, yes, the messaging is, you know, changes bit by bit as culture changes, as we're looking at our audience.
So is there a long-term plan to this? Or does it just kind of have to be a wave that you ride and navigate as those changes take place in culture and as you are made aware of these stories and how those two start to kind of ride together?
You know, I wish we could say we had a 5-year plan or a 10-year plan. Actually, what is happening now and what has happened in the past is God continues to give us new exciting opportunities, new partnership opportunities, new ways to work with other ministries. We, you know, obviously create a lot of tools, the films and the discipleship materials. So we're always excited when other ministries come to us and say, could we use your tools in our strategy? And virtually 100% of the time, the answer is yes. Let's figure out how we can best serve you to do that. And for example, we're partnering with a ministry that's putting the films into prisons in the U.S.
Oh, where, nice.
We've been contacted by a Christian broadcaster that is in most of Africa, wanting us to put together 30-minute shows to play, you know, using our existing films, but then having some material to, you know, to kind of weave them together. And with men's ministries asking, could they use our discipleship materials to provide to their audience? so they can grow as followers of Christ. So a lot of what we're doing at the moment, we continue to create new content. We continue to film new films, but we also want to be really good partners. What God has given to us, we want to give away and provide to others.
Well, and it's an interesting full circle sort of thing, just in you saying that right there, that you start off as a church planting organization and this I Am Second thing seemed a little bit off your radar, but how ultimately the two points seem to be coming back together in something like helping a church with discipleship stuff. And that to me is a fantastic handshake to make that, yeah, maybe that's not the same as planting a church, but you're still able to come in there and undergird a church by having all these various things kind of, you know, intersect.
Yes. But, I mean, and the intersection is not only with churches and other ministries, but here's just another example of God doing something that just surprises us. You know, the NCAA changed their rules about athletes being sponsored.
Mm-hmm.
And so all of a sudden we start getting contacted by athlete after athlete after athlete. Hey, now with the rule change, will I Am Second support us, sponsor us?
Interesting.
And of course, we're a nonprofit. We're not going to be able to sponsor athletes financially, but we may be able to give them some wristbands to give away. We want to train them in evangelism and discipleship so they can be an ambassador for Christ, as well as wear the I Am Second t-shirt. And so we're scrambling to figure out, okay, what type of program can we put together to propel these athletes into greater commitment to Christ and greater effectiveness in His kingdom? Just because of this secular organization, the NCAA, making a simple, well, it's a pretty far-reaching rule change. So that's just an example of God dropping something in our lap that we want to be good stewards of and figure out how to advance His kingdom through serving these athletes.
That's absolutely fascinating to me that you can come behind a college athlete and help them use their platform to further the gospel.
Yes.
When I'm sure that there's a good number of them that are just seeing dollar signs in this new ruling. Gosh, I just pray for those that do have their head and heart on straight, that they could see what an amazing opportunity they have in that newness to say, oh, no, what I'm going to do is make a stand for Christ right here.
Yeah, and a small minority are going to be in a position to benefit financially from that.
Sure.
But every athlete, every collegiate athlete, whether they're getting funded, sponsored by someone who's willing to pay or they're not, they can become a ambassador for Christ. So we're happy to help them. Our methods are simple and they are effective by the grace of God. And so we're looking forward to connecting with a lot of them.
That is just awesome. Mike, I cannot thank you enough. I feel like I've got plenty here for an episode, but I don't ever like to just make a hard cut at the end. Is there anything that you thought we were going to talk about and didn't get to, or just something else that you felt like you needed to share about what's going on with I Am Second or what's coming with I Am Second?
Okay. Let me tell you about something that's going to happen probably in September that your listeners may be interested in getting involved.
Okay.
Probably in the middle of September, we're going to be launching what we call the My Second Story Challenge. And it's going to be a social media challenge, hopefully similar to the ALS, you know, ice bucket challenge, where people see their friends doing it and they want to do it as well. But we're going to equip people to tell their Jesus story, their testimony in 30 seconds or less, and then film it and post it online and use the hashtag My Second Story Challenge. And so we're setting up a web page so people can learn how to do that. It's going to be super simple. But we'd like to have all your listeners participate in that when it's live. And since this probably will air before it launches by just maybe 2 or 3 weeks, they can go to iamsecond.com and they can sign up for the Live Second community. Just sign up for the Live Second community. It's free. And then when we get ready to launch the My Second Story Challenge, they'll get the information and be some of the first to post their stories online. So we think it's going to be a fun thing, an exciting thing. And we want to see Jesus lifted up in so many different segments of society just by believers posting their Jesus story online.
That is so awesome. Mike, I am so glad that you were willing to do this because I'm very much a process guy, and I love to know, like we've been through, the Genesis to the now, and just some of those inner workings of how things have come together. And even though we've already talked about it, just the depth of which that these things have been considered, and that these are good catch systems, and these are good ongoing discipleship decisions, and that you're actually putting the resources in play to really get people empowered to do the very things that you're talking about as a believer, and as a very long time media creator. I'm kind of flabbergasted just to the layers of what you've got going on.
Well, thank you. It's by the grace of God. He's brought a lot of talented people to our team. And we have everything we do is his spirit empowering different people on our team. And, I'd say every single one of these things or all these things were not created by one or two people, but by a team of people all adding their contribution with their giftedness, their experience, their points of view, their perspective. So it's been a very exciting ride watching God work in so many different ways.
As a video producer, I appreciate the high quality of the I Am Second films. And as a Christ follower, I'm a big fan of the vulnerable stories shared in each one. Not cheesy platitudes tied up with a pretty bow, but stories that remind me that we're all just people in process. Please check out the short films and other resources available at iamsecond.com. Oh, and before you run off to something else, I have a very special giveaway, and it just takes a little bit of effort from you. All you have to do is go to Apple Podcasts and leave a good review for The Nook. It's a simple thing that really helps others discover this podcast. Now, once you've done that, just send me a screen grab of your review along with your mailing address, and I will send you an I Am Second silicone wristband and a Nook podcast sticker for your laptop or water bottle. That's all you have to do, and I will send these things to you. Just send them along to my email address, which is Stephen@nookpodcast.com. That's Stephen with a V at nookpodcast.com. In the show notes, I've got links to the Nook Facebook page and to my social media feeds if you'd like to follow along. And if you'd like to help this show financially, all you have to do is buy me a coffee. There's a link for that in the show notes as well. Thank you so much for listening, and I will catch you here next time in the Nook. The Nook Podcast is a production of Sozo Digital Media.